So today we do some exercises and continue the theory also. First, there is a remark. So we have seen that there is isometry allows to put in correspondence an Hilbert space with its dual. And this is an isometry. So in some sense, in a Hilbert space, we could, if we want, identify this with this, if we want. And therefore, passing to the star of this, we could also identify H with its dual, B dual, H star star. In general, if we have, say, a Banach space, then there is a map, natural map, sending E not into its dual, but into its bidual. So this is, by definition, the dual of the dual, which is the definition of this map. So if I have a point x, then J of x is an element of E star star. Therefore, is, by definition, a linear map sending E star . Therefore, to say who is this J of X, to say exactly what element of E star star it is, one say it is enough to say how it acts on elements of E star. So the definition of J of X, the definition, is the following. So you see, J of X is an element of the bidual. Therefore, it is a linear continuous map on the dual. Right? What does it mean? It means that in input, you have an element of the dual. In input, you have a linear map. So J of X acts on F, by definition, as F acts on X. So this, I repeat, this is an element of E star star. This is an element of E star. This is an element of E star. This is an element of E. So this symbol here is the duality between the bidual and the dual. And unfortunately, I am using the same symbol for a different duality, is the duality between the dual and the original space. So to be more precise, one should write, should distinguish maybe using different symbols, and therefore one should write something like, if you want, something like this. Remember that it's duality between different spaces. So you see, now to any x, we have J of x. And let us compute the norm of J of x. Huh? the norm in E star star. It is by definition the supremum of J of X F such that F star is less than or equal than 1. Okay, this is the definition. Oh, by the way, of course, this is if you act to the sum x1 plus x2, this is f comma x1 plus x2. So you have linearity. Now, what is this? By definition, the definition of this map is this. So this is fx such that but we have seen yesterday one of the corollaries of Banach was this, that this is exactly equal to Ex, if you remember. This is corollary of Banach. What does this mean? Well, it means that the map J preserves the norms. This means that this is an isometry. Okay? J what does it mean, partial isometry?
Partial isometry is E is isometric to some subspace of E double prime.
Yes, double star star. So this way you can look, so this is a way so we can identify E with J of E, if you want. And this is an element of E star star. So at least we know that E, if we want, can be embedded into E star star. The point is that in general, this is not surjective. So in general, this is a proper subset of E star star. And not necessarily, you cannot in general identify E with E star star. But just you can embed E inside E star star isometrically. In Hilbert is different. Because in Hilbert we can. Even more, because you can also identify it with H star. So there are some spaces. In general, this map is not surjective. We have already almost seen this. When we studied space of sequences, we saw that if we have C0, then we pass to L1, and then from L1 to L infinity. Remember? I mean, the dual of C0 was realized as L1, and the dual of L1 was realized as L infinity. And therefore, the bidual of C0 was realized sort of L infinity, which is not C0. It's larger. So in general, this is not surjective. This map J is not surjective. So in general, not surjective. when it is, the space is called reflexive. When it is surjective, of course, this kind of phenomena you don't see in finite dimension. In finite dimension, you can always identify a finite dimensional vector space with its dual, and then with its bidual, and so on. So this fact that this is not surjective is a fact that you see in infinite dimensions for suitable Banach spaces. There are examples, as we already remarked, that of non-reflexive Banach spaces, but there are examples also of Banach and not Hilbert reflexive spaces. Do you have some examples in mind of non-Hilbert Banach reflexive? I don't think so. Even if at the moment I don't know exactly who is the dual of the measures, because you pass to the space of measures, right? For instance, continuous with compact support, you pass to the random measures. If they have if you take continuous with zero at infinity, you pass, depends. It's a space of measure, but then taking the dual, it's much more difficult. I think it's more simple. LP with P strictly larger than 1 and strictly smaller than infinity. You know that when you take LP, then the dual can be identified with LP prime, P prime the conjugate exponent. And then you redual once more and educate the conjugate and the conjugate and then go back. Okay. Another exercise. No, this is not an exercise. This is far from being an exercise, but it is interesting to have this map J. Now, an exercise. Say a Banach space, and take 2 points, different points. Then there exists L, which separates these points. The duality between L and X. Remember that my notation, I'm switching notation for convenience. Sometimes I use this, sometimes I use this, okay? But this is a notation. There are sufficiently enough linear, continuous functionals on a Banach space, at least to separate points. Sufficiently many. So do you have some suggestions for doing this? Yes, you take x minus y. You take x minus y, which is different from 0. Then you take the linear span. The linear span, let me call it maybe g. Span over r, of x minus y. And then you can define, some this, say g of lambda x minus y equal to, for instance, to for instance, lambda times norm of x minus y, for any lambda into the real. Also, probably it works. Also is okay. We can take also equal to lambda. Okay. So this is a linear continuous functional on small g, on capital G. And therefore, by Hahn-Banach, this can be extended into a big, into a F. So there exists a continuous linear function on the whole ambient space extending G. So let me call this capital L and not F. Let me call it capital L. Okay. I change notation a little bit. So you see what happens to. Well, and then one checks that. Then. L of x minus y is non-zero. Because L of x minus y coincides with g of x minus y, which is this norm, which is non-zero. And therefore, L of x is different from L of y, because this is linear. Okay. So, there are several linear functionals. Other exercises before going to other consequences of the Hahn-Banach. So what is hyperplane in a norm space, actually. So N norm space well, we can give the definition in two ways of hyperplane. Let me denote it by M is a hyperplane. One would like to say that it has codimension. It is a vector space of codimension one. Okay, one should make this rigorous. Codimension one linear space. So there are two possibilities. One is the following: is that N can be written as a M times R, let me denote it X naught. So there exists one point out of M such that this. Or, well, it is an exercise to show that equivalently, there is an equivalent way is to say that there exists a linear continuous. So I assume we are in Banach just for simplicity. Then there exists such that there exists L linear such that there is a linear function n such that m is equal to, and there exists alpha in R such that is the set where L is equal to alpha, hyperplane. Maybe not a vector space, but also an affine hyperplane. An affine, so a translation of a vector space far from the origin still is an hyperplane, and therefore it's a level set of a linear functional. So this is definition of hyperplane. And
from what do you know that if this is blank, this you can, this L star is non-empty.
L star is non-empty,
no,
yeah.
It's not bad, like, is it?
That L star is non-empty? Oh, let me see, eh? Well, this is true in normal space, but also in normal space. I think that I'm just using, well, no, I am using the continuity. So I am using the topological version of Banach space. So the question is that, can we say that this is true in more general? So the proof of the topological version of Banach was do we use completeness or not? Maybe not. No. So this is okay also in normal space. Hmm? I wrote Banach for simplicity, okay? Okay, so, well, this is a hyperplane, so sort of hyperplane like in finite dimensional space. Say, is something which is affine, could be also a subspace, that's not so important. I mean, if it passed through the origin or not. The important point is some, is to say that it has codimension one in the sense that the outside of M, say, is one dimensional somehow. Okay, this explains the word hyper in front of plane. Now. Now, of course, this hyperplane is closed. Another exercise, which, however, we have already done, essentially, is that this hyperplane is closed if and only if L is bounded. Huh? Do you agree? We have already seen this. Not exactly. We have seen that the kernel of a linear functional is closed if and only if the linear map is continuous or bounded, okay? This is a little bit more. It says not only L equal to zero, closed, but for any alpha, L equal to alpha, closed. Well, they are homomorphic. L equal to alpha is homomorphic to L equal to zero. So, exercise, L, for any alpha, L equal to alpha closed if and only if L is continuous also. Okay? So you add the word here, bounded. If you add here bounded, then you find that L equal to alpha is closed. Okay? And vice versa. Okay, now examples of, so these are for what concerns hyperplanes and example. Other exercises, maybe. Now let me go to a subspace, general subspace. Assume that S is contained into some Banach, if you want. And S finite dimensional. Then you should prove that S is closed. So this is just to have some intuition of what are subsets of infinite dimensional spaces. We have seen something. Do you remember we made an exercise on the interior part of pardon? The interior is of a vector subspace. The interior is empty. So like in finite dimensional space, if you take a line in R2 or a plane in R3, they have empty interior. A plane in R2 have codimension 1, so it's a hyperplane. Okay. Any finite dimensional vector space, subspace, is closed. This is an exercise. And then the closure of S is a closed subspace. So this is item one. Item two, of course, here there is no assumption on the dimension of S. So take any subspace. Maybe could not be closed. Why? We don't know. Could not be closed. If it is not closed, we close it. We take the closure. Then the exercise says that this is still a subspace. Say Banach for simplicity. These are exercises. Now it is interesting. One could wonder: are there non-closed subspaces? Because this suggests that there are, right? So are there non-trivial, non-closed subspaces of a Banach space? So let us try to see if we can do an example. Okay, so this is our homework. Now exercise. So take the Banach space small L1, and then take the vector subspace defined as follows. V is the linear span over R of the following vectors, so En. Okay. What is this? So as usual, we use the standard notation. And so EI is 0, 0, 1, 0, etc. at the ith position. Then we have a vector space, because this is the span. So by definition, it's a vector space. So finite linear combinations of elements of this sort. Okay. Finite linear combination with real coefficients. So this is a vector subspace. Vector space contained in L1, for instance. The point is that, is this closed? So you have, is this closed? It is not closed because there is an. It's not. Do you agree?
Yes. Okay, for V, we agree. But what is V?
I don't want to say what is this, but I just want to say that there is one element here which is outside here. This is enough. Is V closed? You have to erase this. And so it is not. So I just show that there is one element in the closure which is outside V. It is enough. And yes, exactly. E1 is not in V because it is... It is not in V. But on the other hand, it is easy to see that E1 minus this difference obviously goes to zero as n goes to infinity. Okay, so there is a sequence of elements of V converging to E1. And so E1 is in the closure. So E1 is not in V, but is in the closure of V. And therefore, as a consequence, V is a subspace which is not closed. Is a proper subspace which is not closed. I think that this phenomenon we don't see in finite dimension. We don't see it. Any subspace in finite dimension is closed. Okay? So maybe it is useful in functional analysis to isolate what kind of statements are really due to the infinite dimensions and what they are still true in finite dimension. Maybe just to start, right? So this we don't see in finite dimension, like it is written here. And so let's see if there is something else. Yes, maybe this one, exercise. Let V be contained in E. Hyperplane if V is not closed, then V is dense. So we know that there are non-closed subspaces. Now, here there is a little bit more. It's a hyperplane. Well, it is not a subspace because maybe affine, but doesn't matter. Here is a hyperplane. Assume it is not closed. Then you close it. The closure is still a subspace, right? But the but the hyperplane has codimension 1. So if you close it, you have all the space. This means it is dense. So try to make this rigorous, but the proof is exactly this one. Okay. So if it is not closed, you take a point outside, and then you close it. This is still a subspace. You remember the definition of hyperplane, and then you cover all the space. So this is a home. Fine, let me see if there are other exercises. No, maybe not. So, okay. So, now we go back to the Hambanach. So we see other consequences of the Hambanach. So, okay, so maybe I can state. Theorem. So assume that E is a Banach space, and let A be a subset of E, and B a subset of E with the following properties. So assume that A is open, convex, B is convex. Assume that the intersection between A and B is empty. So you have two convex sets. Maybe this is a convex set. Then you have another convex set, like this. So this is A. This is B. Then the theorem says that there exists, a closed hyperplane with the following property. So notice it is closed. This means that we have to look for linear continuous functional. But the point is that there is a close in the picture, something like this, say, which separates the two convex sets. Says that one convex set is in a half space, and the other convex set is in the other half space. How can I say this? Okay, so this is a L equal to alpha maybe. L equal to alpha, the green line, goes hyperplane separating A and B. What does it mean separating? It means that, namely, there exists, that is, idest exist a linear continuous linear bounded such that, well, you have to think about, you have this, the graph of, you have the graph of your hyperplane, and this means that this is in a sublevel alpha, and this is in the superlevel alpha, right? So there exists a linear band such that, say, for instance, A is contained in L less than or equal than alpha, and B is contained in this super level, alpha super level. Or in other words, for any A in A, L of A is less than or equal than alpha, and for any B in B, L of B is larger or equal than alpha. This is equivalent to this. Okay. So you have to think about, yes, simply the word separating is okay. The point is that here there is this closed. So you have to look for something which is continuous. Eh? So it's not trivial. And so this is one version. And then there is, before doing the proof, as yesterday, I think that we will state the theorem, then we make some corollaries, comments, and then we try to prove it. So now crucial assumptions here are this and convexity. And of course, they must be disjoint, otherwise, in general, you cannot. Okay, so let me write. So this is theorem one. Now, let me state theorem two. So, E Banach, A and B contained in E. Assumption one, two, and three. So, one. A is non-empty and is convex. Two, B is non-empty and is convex. Three, they are disjoint. So here you see I have not written open. Now I add closed here. And compact here. So what could happen in this picture? In this picture, concerning theory, I will state the thesis, but in this picture it would happen the following. I could imagine this open convex set, a little bit larger, but open, still open. Okay. This is A, which is open. So the boundary in infinite dimension, the boundary is not in A. And then I can have another convex set like this, just going to this point. Okay. Still, we can separate, since we have here the large inequalities, we can still see that this is still a reasonable, even in this condition. When this point is exactly, this goes here, say this point belongs, say, to B, but does not belong to A because A is open, so that they are still disjoint. And still, we can imagine the green line. Now, here the situation is slightly different, because now you are assuming, say, that A is closed. So A is closed, assume you are in finite dimension. So A is closed, now you add also the boundary, right? But B is more now in finite dimension, B is even compact. So and they are disjoint, right? So now this situation is not allowed anymore, because this endpoint would belong both to B and to A, right? So one imagines something like, okay, this is closed, this is closed, okay, maybe it's infinite, convex, I don't know, but closed. And then this is compact, however. Now the idea is that, well, under this condition, there is a little bit space in between, and so we can gain some epsilon. What does it mean? Well, it means that there exists positive epsilon, and there exists a linear linear and bounded, such that now I strictly separating. I mean, one is in the alpha minus epsilon sublevel, and the other is inside the alpha plus epsilon superlevel. So there is some space, such that A is contained in the and B is contained something like this. Okay. So this is the statement of theorem one. Of course, here compactness will be crucial in some sense to have this small space. You see, in finite dimension, what could you say in finite dimension? Well, you could say, well, I have a closed set, a compact set. They are disjoint. Then they are at positive distance. Well, here we are not in finite dimension. We are in infinite dimension, but at least in finite dimension, there is some distance in between this and the other one. Okay. So we gain a small space. And still here, one gains. In this sense, one can have this small space separating. So in some sense, I could enlarge a little bit one of them and find, I could enlarge, so take points of distance, say, epsilon, and then still have this statement for the enlarged set. Now, however, we will see the proof. But before then, before doing the proof, I need some. I would like to show you some corollary of theorem 1 and theorem 2 in the order. So, well, this is the first corollary, density. I will tell you now in which sense this is called density criterion. Okay, so assume that F is a subspace of E, and assume that this is not, this is strictly contained in E. Then there exists, let me call it L from in a star. There exists a linear continuous function in star such that L of x is equal to 0 for any x in F, and L is not identically 0. Okay. This is the density criterion. Now, in which sense it is a density criterion, then we will prove it a density criterion. Density criterion, in this is used usually as follows. Assume that you want to show that some subspace is dense. Assume that we want to show, this is not the proof of the density of the corollary, it's just a consequence of the corollary. Then I will prove the corollary. Okay? How I use this corollary? Assume that we want to show that some subspace, F of V is dense. This means this. Then it is enough to show, then it is sufficient to show that given L star LX equals 0 on F, for any x in F, implies that L is identically 0. Okay? This is very useful. So in general, assume that you have a subspace, you want to show it is dense. Well, you take any linear continuous function vanishing on F, and then you prove that this, if you prove that this is identical, vanishes everywhere, then necessarily F was dense. Because if it is not dense, then you contradict this statement. Is it clear? Okay? So this is usually used as follows, this corollary. Okay. Now, how can we prove this corollary? So let us go through the proof of the corollary now. So we have proof of the corollary. Take a point. So if F is a subspace, so but we know that by assumption this is strictly contained in E. So we can take a point outside. Okay. We can take a point outside, and now we apply theorem 2. with the following choice. I don't remember which was the compact and which was the closed set. B was compact. So B is equal to X naught, and A is equal to F bar. Okay? So F is a subspace. By in homework, F bar is a subspace. Okay? In particular, F bar is convex. Okay? So, F bar is convex, closed, non-empty. Well, non-empty subspace. Add non-empty here, okay? F bar, so F bar is in the assumptions of theorem 2. B is a compact, convex, non-empty set. By this inclusion, they are disjoint. So the intersection of B and A is empty. Okay? So we are in the assumptions of theorem 2. Therefore, we can find we can find a linear continuous there exists alpha, let's say there exists L linear and continuous, bounded, linear and bounded, and then there exists alpha such that, say, such that I am strictly separating, so I even don't take epsilon, but I have the strict inequalities here. So L of A is less than alpha, less than L X naught. This for any A in A. I even don't need epsilon here, but I just need the strict inequalities, okay? I have not used one assumption. Well, not completely at least. But now I remember that A is a subspace because it's the closure of a subspace. So A itself is a subspace. So it is this inequality is not possible. Unless L is identically equal to zero. Because this is less than a number. But then I can change sign to A. And I can multiply it by any real number. 1,000 and minus 1,000. Is not this inequality is not possible. You see? This is subspace. I can change sign. I can multiply for any big number here, positive and negative. OK. And therefore, the conclusion is that unless this is vanishes identically on F, this is the only possibility, this equal to zero. If it is not zero, I can multiply by a big positive or negative number. So the only conclusion that it is possible, so this is impossible unless this is equal to zero. which is the conclusion. So this is one assumption, one corollary, and then let me show you another interesting corollary. So this is the density criterion. Corollary. So assume that a star is separable. Then E is separable. And the converse is not true. Remark. E separable does not imply, in general, that the dual is separable. Sorry. Why is this so? L1 is separable, L infinity. Sorry. L1 is separable. We know that we can realize the dual of L1 as small L infinity. This is an exercise that we have made. But L1 star is not. On the other hand, we can use so this is corollary 1. This is corollary 2. The claim is that we can use corollary 1 to show corollary 2, and therefore have this interesting conclusion on separability. So, the proof of corollary 2. So, if it is separable, a star separable, we can choose, implies that we can choose a countable dense subset of a star. So, there exists, let me call this Fn, contained in a star, countable dense subset. Okay. Now, for any n, now fix epsilon positive, so take for any n, first take xn, take for any n xn into E with the following properties. Fn divided by xn larger than or equal than 1/2. Xn. Okay, so I take for any n in correspondence on this surface, if you remember the definition of norm of Fn, which is the supremo of this divided by this, you can always choose this. Remember in the definition. Remember the definition of, do you agree with this? Do you agree? It is the supremum of this divided by this, and therefore I can. So now I have a family, countable family of Xn, and then I can take the span. We can consider the linear span with rational coefficients of Xn. So we can consider the span of Xn. It is, of course, yet countable, because I'm countable contained in E. And it is also dense, dense in the span over the real. So let me call this V. So if I show that V is dense, I am done. We agree? Because then this is dense in this, this is in dense in E, and therefore the span over Q is dense. Is it okay? No? Which is the point? Other questions on this? This is okay? So I have chosen one, for any n, one point of your space. Okay, satisfying this inequality. Then I would like to show that now I'm looking for a countable dense subset of E, right? Because I want to show that E is separable. So I have to find this countable dense subset. So the idea is, okay, I take all linear finite combinations of this with rational coefficients. Okay? And this is this, and this is yet countable. Since Q is dense in R, and these are finite sums, this object is dense in this. Okay? And I call this V. Now, I try to prove that V is dense. So try to prove. Let us try to show. Let us show that V is dense. If we show that V is dense, then this is dense also, because this is dense in this, this is dense in V, and V is dense in E, and therefore also this is dense in E. Okay? Fine. So we have to show this now. Let us try to show this. And now we apply the corollary 1. The density criterion. We want to show that some subspace, you see this is a subspace, V is a subspace. The closure of a subspace is a subspace. We want to show that this is dense, and therefore, we apply the density criterion. I mean, the consequence of the density criterion was, I want to show that something, some subspace is dense, so I take any linear function on V, and I show that this is zero. Vanishing on V, then it is identically zero. Okay, so. So let me denote it by L. From E to R, L linear and bounded. And assume that I know that L, LV is equal to zero for any V in V. And then we have to show that L is identical to zero. Okay, so now fix epsilon positive. Take. So now we know that Fn is dense. Therefore, there is Fn minus L is less than epsilon. Okay? So there exists n depending on epsilon such that Fn minus L is less than epsilon. Okay, this is by density because Fn is dense in E star. Okay. Now, no, I mean, this is just to say that given epsilon, there is some element of Fn which is close, epsilon close to L. So fix epsilon. In the ball centered at L of radius epsilon, you take one Fn. OK? It's dense. Now we want to use this inequality and and this assumption here. So we proceed as follows. So we have that epsilon is larger than Fn minus F, which is larger. This is a norm, and so it is larger than Fn minus F. Fn minus F, comma, xn corresponding to this. So to any fn, so we have chosen this n epsilon, right? So we have fn epsilon, maybe. Let me use n epsilon. And given n epsilon, we have xn epsilon. So let me use this x and epsilon here. Maybe it is better to use an epsilon here. So, okay. X and epsilon. F and epsilon minus L. I'm making some mistake in the notation. This is capital L, sorry. this is by definition of norm, of course, which is the supremum of this quotient. Eh? So what is this now? So we know that xn epsilon, remember xn epsilon is in, is in V. Yes, of course. So xn epsilon is important to remark that xn epsilon belongs to V. Okay. So this is equal to what? We have fn epsilon comma xn epsilon minus L comma xn epsilon divided by this. And now we are going to use this. So if in place of V we take xn epsilon, this is equal to 0. Because xn epsilon is in V. Okay, this means that this is equal to 0.
It's bigger or equal 1 over 2 fn epsilon.
At the end. But let me go slowly. This is 0, right? This is equal to 0 because of star and star, where star is this. Okay, and star is this. Okay. So this is simply this x and epsilon divided by x and epsilon. And now we use assumption, this assumption. So by this assumption, by this choice, we have that this is larger than 1/2 the norm, as he was saying exactly this. So you see, interestingly, we have found that at the end of these inequalities, f and epsilon, so for any epsilon positive, exist an epsilon such that f and epsilon is less than 2 epsilon. Okay. So from one hand, so this says that along a subsequence, fn epsilon is going to 0. But along a subsequence, it is also going to f, because we have this. So take epsilon, say, equal 1 over k, 1 over n. Then you can find a sequence of indices such that along this subsequence, fn converges to L. And at the same time, epsilon is 1 over n, and so this converges to 0. Therefore, by the uniqueness of the limit, f is equal to 0, necessarily. L is equal, I'm confusing f with L. I repeat. Along a subsequence, this is going to L, this is going to 0, therefore L is equal to 0. And this says, so we have to show that L equal to 0. We have shown that L is equal to 0. Therefore, necessarily, V was dense as a consequence of corollary 1 of Hambanach. So this is a quite interesting result on structure of these strange infinite dimensional spaces at the end. I think that I have said all consequences that I want to say on theorem 1 and 2. So now we have to show those theorems. So proof of theorem 1. So you remember the proof of theorem, Hambach theorem of yesterday was made into two steps. The first step was how to define the extension at a point on the linear span of one point outside, keeping the constraint. And then there is the Zorn abstract, Zorn machinery. Now, we want to use that theorem also in this case, but still we start with the computational part, assuming that, now I don't remember if A and B, maybe A was open, convex open, A was, so I assume that B is just a point, for simplicity. So assume for the moment. So we now we start to do the proof in the simple case that we have just one point outside. So you want to separate an open convex set with a closed hyperplane, separate the open object and the point outside, which is a convex set. Okay. So here, there is no time today to conclude the proof. Of course, we have 5 minutes. So, but maybe what I can say, just to make a picture to convince you, which is the strategy. Okay. So let me try to draw some picture in finite dimensions, so R2. Okay. This is a convex A. And this is a point outside, x naught. Now, the first thing that we will do, so this is, first of all, A is open. So A is convex and open. So by translation, it is very convenient to put the origin of our vector space inside A. So we translate the origin so that maybe the origin was here. Okay, now we translate everything so that now the origin is here. Okay, somewhere, I don't know, here, the origin. So by translation, we can do the following interesting assumption that 0 is in A. So remember that A is open, so A coincides with its interior. So now we have a convex set with the origin in its interior. Convex set with the origin in its interior. Okay. This is the origin. Now we want to apply, so there is a general principle. When you have a convex set with the origin in its interior, this corresponds essentially to a seminorm. It is essentially the unit ball of a seminorm, and conversely, if you have a seminorm, then take the unit ball, where the unit ball is a convex set containing the origin in its interior. So let me make just some comments here. Okay, so finite dimension. You have a convex body, okay? Like this. The origin is here. Well, this is a convex set with non-empty interior, and the origin is in the interior. Then it is not difficult to define a one homogeneous function. Thinking of R2, eh? Now, this is in R2. This is the origin. It is not difficult to find a norm, essentially, having this as a unit ball. Not quite a norm, exactly, because this is not symmetric with respect to the origin, right? The origin is here, and this is not symmetric. Symmetric would mean that if you have a point here, then you have also the opposite inside. But you have a point here, the opposite is outside. So this is not symmetric. If it were symmetric, then it is also convex and bounded, then it is easy to look at this as the unit sublevel set of a homogeneous norm. And then I will tell you, this is called the gauge, that there is a way to define a function in a natural way such that this is to construct the norm starting from the unit ball. Conversely, it is much more easier. Assume that I have given you a one homogeneous convex function, cut at level one, that object is convex. It contains the origin in its interior. So cut at level one, put it horizontal in the horizontal plane. This is the one level subset containing the origin somewhere. So now, which are the difficulties? Well, first of all, this object is not symmetric with respect to the origin. This is the reason for which, in the Banach theorem of yesterday, we have written lambda positive and not modulus of lambda. Remember, we have written p of lambda x equal lambda p of x, but only for lambda positive. And this was to include non-symmetric sets like this. Because if you put this for any real, then essentially you are symmetric. So if you want to include the cases in which you have no symmetry, you cannot ask for this strong assumption, just ask for this for positive lambda. Okay, so first difficulty is this. Second difficulty in finite dimension, just to understand that, is that you can have a convex body, but this, say, could be infinite. So this creates some degeneracy in your norm. It's not really a norm, actually. Because when this is infinite, then here there is a direction, essentially, where you pay nothing. I mean, there is a degeneracy here in the norm. So, for instance, the norm coming from this convex set is not equivalent to the Euclidean norm. So you cannot put, yes, of course you can put a Euclidean ball, but you cannot put a Euclidean ball outside. This you cannot. And so you expect that if you want to have an inequalities between this norm and this other, you can have just only one inequality and not two inequalities. They cannot be controlled one each other because this is unbounded. So, I mean, asking convexity of A and open says that you can assume that zero is in the interior, but you cannot assume that in finite dimension, for instance, that this is bounded, and you cannot assume it is symmetric. Okay, doesn't matter. We can do the proof in any case. But keeping in mind this. Now, which is the definition, the natural definition of passing from a convex object to a norm, or semi-norm, or whatever. I mean, even less than a semi-norm, but inside the statement of Hambanach. Okay, so if you have C, in general, you have, say, C convex with zero in the interior, so with non-empty interior in particular, then there is a function defined in the ambient space which is called maybe the gauge function of C itself. And is the, what do you do? The idea is the following. You take the infimum . This is the definition. What is the? It is the, exactly, sorry. This, yeah, okay, I'm changing the name. For, maybe I'm wrong, Minkowski functional. Minkowski, is, huh? Minkowski functional. Codes also? Gauge, the gauge, gauge in France, maybe gauge. Minkowski. Let us call this Minkowski. So what we are doing here? Well, we are doing the following. So we have a convex body. This is the origin. We want to define at a point x a function. That, and then you do this. I mean, you take first, you should prove that this set is absorbing points. It absorbs points in the sense that if you homothetize it, sooner or later, you will include any point x. So first, you have to show that this is obvious in finite dimension, but this is true also in infinite dimension. Once this has the origin in its interior, it is convex, then it absorbs points. Namely, given any point, you can scale your C so large with an alpha so large so that alpha times C becomes so large that includes X. Like a ball. If you have a ball, then you take a point outside, then you take 1,000 the radius of a ball, sooner or later you include the point X. And then you take the smallest alpha such that you have included X. So you start from outside, there is a big alpha, small, small, small. At some moment, the smallest alpha you can have, then this is the value of P at x. So we will show on the next lecture that this is exactly the function such that its one sublevel set is C. And you see, now the idea is the following. Well, I have a point outside. Here, above this, I have a linear, sort of linear function. Now I define also, say, g of x on the linear span equal lambda, say, so that the g of x is 1. It is rather clear that this is outside. Remember the idea that if you have one convex set inside the other and they take the linear functions, then the linear functions corresponding to the smallest set is above the linear function corresponding to the larger set. And therefore, here is rather clear that this P should be above this G. Well, if this is true, then we are almost in the condition to apply Hahn-Banach. Because we have almost a semi-norm P above a linear function G, and so on and so on. This is more or less the idea of the proof. We cannot do this in 5 minutes. We will do this. This is just the idea.